Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. In this second video on specimen processing, we're going to talk about central processing, also often referred to as CP. So specimens entering the lab are usually first handled by central processing, which is an area devoted to accessioning and sorting samples as they arrive. Accessioning a sample is actually just recording the date and time of arrival in the computer, along with the date and time of collection, which is usually not the same as the date and time of arrival into the lab. Each sample has an accession number, which is a unique identifying number that is used for tracking the sample in the lab, and it's associated with a specific order that the physician came in. And so we use the accession number, and if everything is entered correctly, you should be able to track when the order was put in, when the sample was collected, if you have the appropriate collection time and date, and by whom it was collected, when it was processed in, so when was it accessioned in, and then you can even further track it to when it was loaded on the analyzer, when results were ready, when results were finalized, when that crossed over. So it's a very important number to help track specimens and often see where problems may have occurred. So central processing is also usually responsible for centrifuging the samples to separate the plasma or serum from the cellular elements, and for preparing aliquots. And aliquots are small portions of the specimen that can be transferred into separate containers for distribution to a variety of lab departments. Before centrifuging, the stopper should remain on the sample to prevent its contamination or alteration. So clotting, serum specimens must be completely clotted before centrifugation. So complete clotting may take 30 to 45 minutes at room temperature. It could take even longer if the patient is on blood thinners. Samples with clot activators, including serum separator tubes, will clot within 30 minutes. And if thrombin is used, complete clotting could occur within 5 minutes. If you do not allow a tube to completely clot, you can get what is pictured here, where the sample looked like it was clotted, but it wasn't completely clotted, and it was put in a centrifuge. And after centrifuging, you pull it out, and the area where the serum should be clear here is filled with a fibrin clot. And the way this is remedied is usually we take some little wooden sticks and go in there and very gently wring out the fibrin from the clot, and then pull that out, toss it, put the cap back on, and run it through the centrifuge again. And hopefully that allows just, the serum to be clear and free from all that fibrin mesh, because serum needs to be free from that fibrin. A little bit on centrifuging samples. So a centrifuge spins the sample at a very high speed. It separates components based on density. The cellular elements, which are denser, will move to the bottom, and then the less dense plasma or serum is pushed to the top. And then if you have a serum separator, it will lodge itself here in between the cells and the liquid portion, the plasma or the serum. Unstoppering a tube. So the major risk of stopper removal is the formation of an aerosol, which is a microscopic mist of blood that forms from the droplets inside the tube. And aerosols are especially likely if the tube or ring has been contaminated by blood during collection or transport. So especially if the blood was laid maybe on a counter or something, and so the blood was in contact with the stopper of the tube. Many automated instruments will allow for testing without stopper removal. So in our little example here, the purple top that goes to hematology is usually tested without stopper removal, but this light blue top would have to be centrifugated and or centrifuged, and then the lid is usually removed for coagulation analysis. Of course, this can vary from one instrument to the next. So we have some instruments that are cap piercing and some instruments that are not. And if you put a specimen in an analyzer with a cap on and is not a cap piercing probe, then that probe will crash in the lid of that specimen and it will cause an instrument malfunction. Aliquots, all tubes into which aliquots are placed should be labeled before filling and then capped before delivery to the appropriate department. It is very important to put the right information and to make sure that you are properly labeling the aliquot because they become the specimen, right? Aliquots are usually not poured off because this can cause splashing and aerosol formation. Again, something you do not want. And instead, an aliquot is going to be removed with any one of several types of disposable papating system, especially these very nifty little squeezy, easy to use transfer pipettes. And lastly, let's talk about specimen rejections. Often, if a specimen is going to be rejected, it should be rejected at central processing. So what are reasons to reject a specimen? First, improper or inadequate identification. If a tube comes in the lab and it is not labeled, even if the nurse swears and knows who it is, you really cannot accept it because you cannot be 100% sure of whose blood that is. If the blood is hemolyzed, so you will see that in the tubes that have run through the centrifuge, and hemolysis is when hemoglobin is released from the cells. Hemolysis will happen during collection, not during centrifugation. It's just centrifugation reveals it because you're spinning the cells down. So normally, as you see here, in this example, the plasma or the serum should be a clearer yellow color unless there's some pathology going on with the patient. And it shouldn't be, red or red tinged in any way. So if the incorrect tube was submitted for the test ordered, that could be a reason for rejection. A lot of times tubes are not interchangeable, and it is also not appropriate to pour blood from one type of tube into another type of tube. It needs to be actually collected in the correct tube. If tubes are used past their expiration date, because that can cause incomplete fill and improper preservation of the sample. If there's inadequate ratio of blood to additive, this is especially true for the blue tops. And so that one would be where there's not enough blood in relationship to the additives, and that can cause erroneous results. If there's insufficient volume for testing, the specimen was drawn at the wrong time, so that could be a reason for rejection. If the specimen was contaminated, especially like contaminated with IV fluid, or it's a pea specimen that was contaminated with feces or something like that. I don't know. Anyway, if there's obvious contamination of the specimen, it could be rejected. If it was improperly handled, so that would go back to the first video we did about specimen handling. If it was not kept at the proper temperature, if it needed to be on ice, or if it was not protected from light, or not transported to the lab quickly enough, all of those are improper handling, which could cause a specimen to be rejected. And then bringing a sample to the lab outside the appropriate time frame. An example of that would be maybe a urine specimen or something that was collected from a patient and it sat in the room, was collected in the morning, and it's not discovered until maybe later that afternoon or that evening. Well, that specimen is not any good anymore because it was not appropriately preserved, and it was not delivered to the lab in the appropriate time frame, and so it should be rejected and recollected, unless it's something that's really hard to recollect. But So it is important to make sure that all this happens correctly so that we can have the most accurate results, which are what we want for our patients. So anyway, so that is my second and last video on specimen processing. Thank you.